You're listening to Politics Within Reason, the official podcast of the Party of Reason and Progress. Show the world you care about progress. Go ahead, give us a like or a share. And if you want to learn more or support your purpose, visit partyofreasonandprogress.org.
Tonight on Politics Within Reason, we're going to change things up. I'm your host, Michael Hamm. And tonight we have a really special episode where we dive into some conversations that I think we all need to have. And that is, how do we talk about the tough issues in a constructive and useful way? Especially when you're in an emotionally charged conversation, you're convinced the other person should just be struck down by the rustiest blue shell from Mario to their nether region for saying whatever they said to you. And so with me is a really special guest, Kristjan Sokoli. Kristjan is an NFL player who's played for the Seahawks, Colts, and Saints. And this is an interview, a topic that I'm really excited to have. Kristjan, can you introduce yourself and give us a bit of your background?
What's up, guys? Thank you for having me on the show, Michael and my brother. Really appreciate it.
That's right. And joining us, too, is Mark, Kristjan's brother. And they've actually got this really interesting venture that's going on. Can you guys just give me a bit of a background about it?
Yeah, well, a little bit about us. We are originally from Albania. We're born there. And then when I was 9 and Mark was 5 years old, my brother's laughing, but I think this is a very emotional, dramatic story. I want your listeners to know about this. No, but anyway, we're from Albania in Eastern Europe. So shout out to all our Albanians all over America, all over the world. Grew up in New Jersey. I went to school in Buffalo. He went to school over here in New Jersey, Montclair State. And here we are.
Yeah, you guys actually had to flee Albania. Is that right? Is that what I'm reading your Wikipedia page, right? So that's my only knowledge of the Albanian.
Nice. Yeah, Wikipedia can be very convenient and reliable. Sometimes inconsistent. Sometimes. Yeah. For the most of the stuff in there is pretty, on point. Yeah, I mean, our dad left Albania for a better living here in America and kind of like that.
So you're kind of this really great example of how immigrants make America amazing, right? So you've come from Albania. And I was looking through your Instagram, man. I feel like I got to go work out. Like, your Instagram is something else. You know, I'm just looking through
that. Oh, thank you, man.
Go right to the gym.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Let all the NFL owners know that too.
Yeah. That's right. You're that's right. You're looking around at the moment, as I understand it. But you seem like a pretty good player, and so I really hope the best of luck there. But in the meantime, you're not sitting still, right? You know, you've really got this hard work ethos, and you guys are starting this a mining venture, right? But it's not the normal mining. What are you guys doing?
Yeah, we're not exactly mining for coal.
I hear it's really good business. You might get some great subsidies.
It is. Yeah, what we're doing is Sokoli Mining is the name of our company. We are, I guess, it's a brand new industry. A lot of people don't know a lot about it. It's about the blockchain, cryptocurrency, and basically what our role in it is. We mine for cryptocurrency, and we help the average guy that or girl that wants to get into cryptocurrency and wants to invest in it, but they want to do it with hardware. They want to do it with a legitimate product. They want to do it and feel safer about it instead of just throwing money, at a crypto on the internet. So we help people by building mining rigs for them. Providing them mining essentials, so sometimes some things are hard to find, and a lot of times we can find them, like, these Antminer D3s. We just sold about 6 of them last week. And
whoa.
Yeah, so
look at their Instagram page. What's your Instagram page again?
At Soko Mining.
Yeah, so if you look there,
S-O-K-O Mining, M-I-N-I-N-G.
Okay, yeah, you go there and you look and you see these incredible miners that these guys are putting together.
Thank you, man.
Yeah, those things are
you're too kind.
That's a big machine,
Yeah.
And I'm just looking right now. Bitcoin today, like in the last week, it's gone up, or a couple of weeks, it's gone up nearly $1,000. Is that right? Bitcoin, it seems like? Five to nearly $6,000. And I mean, Bitcoin's the most famous of all the cryptocurrencies. But you guys are looking other places, right?
I'll just jump in here. Thanks for having me on the show. Appreciate it. This is Mark here. Yeah, I mean, Bitcoin price just this past week has been, it went all the way up to 6,000 and then it went back down to 5,500. And it also split. It had a split, which is something unique that these cryptocurrencies do. It split into Bitcoin Gold and regular Bitcoin. Oh, so wow. all Bitcoin holders were awarded a free new currency called Bitcoin Gold, which is right now, it's still leveling out, but it's worth about $140 a coin.
Whoa.
Which is not a bad bonus to just be awarded just for holding Bitcoin.
Wow, that's pretty incredible. I actually had been paying enough attention. I've been on travel and just hadn't seen that news. How do you actually mine for Bitcoins, right? How is it that you guys enable people to go out there and mine for these incredibly valuable Bitcoins? or other cryptocurrencies?
No. Well, we specialize in building rigs that are best for altcoin mining. It's like the alternative coins because they're alternatives to Bitcoin. Actually, another a new altcoin, which I was just talking about, Bitcoin Gold, is also one that we're going to be able to mine with our rigs. The rigs we build just consist of regular, well, it's like the top-notch best graphics cards that you see in regular desktop computers. And basically, these graphics cards are competing with other cards to generate the right code, and they're doing trillions of calculations per second.
Yeah, so you do this brute force calculation, as I understand it. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to verify the blockchain. It's a proof of work. You're just trying to show that you are credible in order to propagate the blockchain. What people want to do when they exchange cryptocurrency is there's a big public ledger out there. And that public ledger tells who owns what part of the currency and who's making transaction. And all of that's verified by these miners.
Exactly. So, people that are just watching from without too much information on cryptocurrencies, you guys see this. You guys see the prices of all these coins just exploding. But behind all that, there's miners that are also making profits on these, on the transaction fees, on building the network, on mining the coins itself. And basically what we're trying to do with Soko Mining is provide that to the average Joe who's trying to get into crypto and start actually mining the coin as well as being a part of the community.
So you know what really struck me about this? And I was just thinking about it because I got friends who do like Tupperware or LuLaRoe or, you know, any number of these like you sell from home kinds of things. And it's kind of interesting to me that this might be a pretty legitimate way to work from home. You know, you're paying for the miner and then you're paying for electricity and you're doing a little bit of gambling on your own. You're trying to figure out which alt currencies, or you might go for Bitcoin, but which of these currencies you're going to, you know, start investing in and start building up a, you know, a huge collection of coins with. And so this really could be something that you do from home to make money. Like it just sits there while you go to work and makes you money. It's kind of strange. Oh,
exactly. Actually, just speaking on that, it's in a way you're basically buying, by buying our product, you're in a way buying a, it's similar to a stock exchange that you own yourself.
Yeah.
Any day you can change what you're investing in. There's no centralized party that controls your money. You basically can change your, instead of investing in a stock, you're investing in a coin. You can change any day what coin you're going to invest in that day without any medium party charging you fees or controlling any of your money.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And what's interesting is you can change the altcoins for any of the other coins. Typically, there's exchanges out there and they have exchange rates. And, you know, you kind of get to play with some really interesting statistics. And like you say, it sort of reminds me of the way the stock market was going at one time.
Yep.
What really makes me wonder, right, during the next recession, is it going to be the common metals like gold and such, whose value is really based on how much work it takes to get more gold into the system? Or is it going to be cryptocurrencies that's like sort of hold steady during it, or both? I don't know. But, you know, we see during like these recessions, gold prices shoot through the roof. You know, I wonder if that's what we're going to see in crypto as well next time.
Exactly. And here's the thing about gold. Like, this is just speculation for what I think, but, you know, gold relies heavily on people still kind of believing in the gold standard, even though we don't base on it too much. But the value of gold can be kind of valued that way. Crypto, here comes crypto out of nowhere that has no worth. And it's exploding.
Yeah.
And so how is that going to weigh into the whole situation?
Yeah. I mean, the worth is sort of related to how hard it is to make something. It's hard to make new gold. Like, I love these Alaska shows where they're going out, you know, digging for gold and stuff. And like, it's a
different to me.
But it shows you like how hard it is to get just tiny amounts of gold. And it's sort of that way with the crypto. But instead, what you're doing is you have this miner sitting in, you know, maybe you just have one or two. But sometimes people have like rooms and rooms of these miners out there, you know, doing, like you say, trillions of calculations, trying to come up with a new coin to add to the system. You know,
welcome to the future where the machines work for us.
That's right. Exactly. Yeah, you can, you know, the plug here, of course, is you can get a Soko machine and it could sit there working for you. I can't.
There you go.
No one can guarantee you're going to get rich, but a lot of people are, right? And that's kind of the point. And it isn't that easy just to get a miner, right? That isn't the simplest thing in the world. And so you should check these guys out. But, you know, the other thing that I wanted to talk to you guys about, because you're sort of experts in this, is what else can we do with the blockchain? Like, what else is interesting about the blockchain?
Yeah, great question, man. I think you can go in a lot of avenues. healthcare, politics, you know, voting, which ties into politics.
Yeah.
Welfare. I mean, this is very speculative right now, but I've just, you know, I've seen some videos and read some articles. Well, guys are making very legitimate points about how you can apply the blockchain and apply a decentralized system to things like healthcare, for example, where, you know, by now you go to the hospital, you're filling out pages and pages of paperwork of things you're filling out every other week that you go there a lot of times. You know, there's a lot of unneeded necessities and burdens, and these could all be removed by a decentralized system that is, you know, secure. Nobody can break into it, you know, because it's not, you know, one controlling third party that can be hacked into.
Yeah.
And it's got maybe all your client, you know, or all your patient information, and maybe, you know, handles your payment systems and the transactions between the healthcare company to the bank and things like that. And I'm being a little vague, but I think, you know, if you go in there and read about it, I think there's a lot of things that make sense.
Yeah. And ever since we started like planning this conversation, one of the things that popped in my head was maybe you could use this in politics. And that's kind of where maybe PORP or somebody like that can come in. For example, there's this new bill that came out that prevents people from gathering together to sue the banks. And maybe it's a good bill. Maybe it's not. But it just sort of appeared. And
that sounds corrupt.
It does sound corrupt, right? It does. And maybe it's not. But that's the whole point, right? What you could do is have a public ledger that shows, you know, from the inception of the idea of this bill, which legislatures contributed which parts of that bill, right? It could be a public blockchain. It could even be secret while it was being put together. But as soon as that bill comes out, the whole blockchain that shows exactly who contributed what to where in that bill could come out. And that'd be really fascinating, you know? And so anyways, I find the blockchain a fascinating concept because what it is it's a public ledger that you can go back and you can read from the beginning.
Yeah, that's a great point, man. I mean, imagine a world where, you know, you're following politics and you don't want to just see a yes, no track record of your accomplishment. You want to see what they were really implementing in the bill. When were they really fighting for it? How hard were they fighting for it? Were they just going along with everybody's idea?
Yeah.
And like you said, in the right kind of system, you can see these kind of things. And that would be really cool. Obviously, it's another thing to implement. But, you know, where there's a wish, there's a way, right?
Yeah, because the blockchain can be done a couple ways, right? But at the end of the day, it's a public ledger. You can either have kind of a protected privacy like you do in Bitcoin. You don't necessarily know who the individual users are, but you can see who has sent money where and how much. But you could also have these blockchains that are not anonymous, and you can see exactly who contributed which part to what to get to a final endpoint. And that's why the blockchain's fascinating. All right. Well, thanks so much for joining us on this part, Mark. I think it's fascinating. Check out their Instagram, which is Soko Mining. We'll post it to our page too and put it in our little article that we write up about this.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, man. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Mark. And so, Kristjan, I wanted to transition to something that you've really brought up. Like, you've brought up this idea that one of the issues that currently exists in, you know, Democratic Party especially is, you know, how these issues, these social issues, get handled. Like, you brought up an interesting question to me, which is, there's this UFC fighter, Fallon Fox, who's a transgender UFC fighter, transitioned from a man to a woman. And, you know, where should that person kind of fit into the UFC?
Yeah, I know. And, you know, not to pick on one example, because
not just one example here, but
yeah, but it is a valid example. It is a valid example in the sense that it brings up a valid point when you think about, you know, you want to allow people to identify with who they are.
Yeah.
Which is fine. I think that makes sense. I think people should have the freedom to be who they want to be, who they think they are. It's up to you to decide who you are. If you want to identify as a woman, man, something else, I think it's all okay.
Right.
You just have to make sure that allowing them this freedom doesn't overstep people's freedoms who want to identify with being straight or being, you know, with being the gender that they are biologically.
Yeah, because the problem in this particular case was that this transgender woman was beating all the, you know, other biologically born women in the UFC, as I understand it. And, you know, they just didn't want to fight this person. And I totally can understand that, right? And so that, you know, makes an interesting conversation. How should we treat equality? And then it comes to this point that not every answer is easy. I think the point you're really trying to make is we should be able to have these conversations, even if they're uncomfortable. Right.
Yeah, you know, that's absolutely. And that's the thing. Not every answer is easy. Not every answer is black and white. And I feel like today's politics, it's either left or right. You know, they want everything to be so defined. Like, either you believe in, you know, lowering taxes to the extreme, or you believe in communism, you know, like, no, is there a logical middle that can make sense, please? Because honestly, in the real world, I feel like usually the good old saying, I'm going to use another saying here.
Yeah, right.
the truth lies somewhere in between, right? And I believe in that, you know, like usually both extremes are wrong, you know.
And you shared this really cool letter that stood out to me, and it was by Nate Boyer, who is a Green Beret and an NFL player. And I just wanted to read this point here. And he's just saying, this is dear every single American. Let me just read this point. Simply put, it seems like we just hate each other. That is far more painful. And that's far more painful to me than any protest or demonstration or rally and tweet. We're told to pick a side. There's a line drawn in the sand. Are you with us or against us? You know, and it's just about once we choose a side, right, we dig in and we want to win. And we're not going to let up.
Yeah. And I love that letter, man. I think
it's a fantastic letter.
Yeah. Nate's a great guy, too. I played with him in the Medal of Honor football game.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Had some really cool times with him. And it's that letter rings home, man, because it's like at the end of the day, we are one nation, and we need to come together. And I don't think coming together is going to really work out by agreeing. No side is going to agree that the other side is right.
Yeah.
Instead, can we come together and think that, you know, we need to be able to have a conversation. We need to be able to find middle ground, or, you know, something like that. We need to be more open to the issues and discuss them and not be so, you know, so holding on to the, you know, the belief systems that we have.
Yeah. Not just shouting everyone down. Right. You know, I mean, you know, I've personally evolved on issues like, let's say, gay marriage, for example. Right. I used to be, you know, pretty against it. I grew up pretty religious. And, you know, the idea of gay marriage wasn't ever on my radar. But then when it was finally, you know, when I got into like high school, I wasn't really for it. And then, you know, overall, I evolved. I got to know people who this impacted. And I realized that it didn't matter all that much. But, I said some things that looking back, I wish I hadn't. And, you know, I'm glad it's not on tape. Right.
Yeah.
And that's sort of the problem, you know, is that we tend to hold people really to this one thing.
Yeah, I agree, man. And that's. I could probably side with you in that I was raised very Christian. And I also initially was thinking, no, gay marriage, that's wrong. You know, marriage is meant to be between man and wife. But once you sit down, you have a conversation with the other side, you know, you hear the other side's points, you try to put yourself in their shoes.
Yeah.
It's like, you know what? Okay. If two guys want to go to a church or court or wherever they want to go, they want to get married. Whatever I'm doing over here in my town or my house did not change. You know, it's not affecting my happiness right now.
Yeah.
So it's really not a big deal. You know, like let people do what makes them happy. You know, as long as it's not, you know, conflicting with, you know, others.
Right. Right. And that's where the conversation in society sort of has to come into. Right. How does it conflict with others? And you know, I do see how like there are really hot button issues today, like transgender rights, and you know, people do feel like it affects them, you know, like for example, the bathroom issue, right? And there's people who are having conversations and they're, you know, going to get shouted down. And unfortunately, it's not really going to get anywhere except entrenching them.
Exactly. And that's the problem. As soon as you come out and maybe say a line that, you know, isn't incorporated with not being for, let's say, transgender bathrooms, you're automatically shouted down and you're thought of as all the ridiculous slogans. You know, that shouldn't be happening. Maybe I'm for all the transgender rights. I'm just bringing this up because I want people to hear, you know, what are negative outcomes of this law if we put in the law that everybody needs a transgender bathroom, you know, or something like that. So, like you were saying yourself, man, we need to open the table and have the ability to have a conversation.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, one of the things that's interesting about the Trump era is that Trump is really good at getting people to pick a side, right? He's good at, I think one of the things you can probably agree with is that President Trump has gone after somebody in a way that you were, you know, kind of laughed about and kind of like, yeah, right. You know, like for example, Jeff Sessions, or when he goes after liberals or somebody like that, right? There's somebody Trump has gone after where you kind of enjoyed it, right?
I know. Absolutely. I think that's what won him a lot of votes, kind of. A lot of people probably weren't with him policy-wise. They're just like, man, this guy's on liberals, on Jeff Sessions, this guy. And it's like
whoever,
people
right?
are just tagging along because he emotionally triggered them in that moment.
Yeah.
And the thing about humans, we all know too well, once you emotionally trigger a human, the logic is kind of in the fog.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, once you change it to an emotional argument, And again, he's just so good at this. And, you know, you're in an industry that is you know, kind of this, you know, center fire of this point, right? The NFL. And, you know, he's just so good at making people kind of pick a side about maybe something they didn't care that much about, right? Like how many people were at home standing for the flag before this issue, right? You know, you're getting chips and
I know
you weren't disrespecting the flag, right? It was just part of the process.
Yeah. I know. Yep. And people make things bigger than they are, of course. You know, yeah. It's like we get divided over, I think, small things too fast. But yeah.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, I think the players who are, you know, choosing to kneel have a really great point about police justice. But I'm not 100% sure this is at this point now advancing that cause. You know, it's bringing some attention to it. But, you know, now that it's changed to a different topic, is maybe a good question. Yeah. But now it's a hard conversation, and it's one that people have picked their sides on.
Exactly. It is, you know, and like you said, this may not be the best way to do it. You know, you could say they're disrespecting the flag because, they probably are disrespecting the flag. But they also have a freedom as an American citizen, as a human being, to kneel for the flag, to sit down for the flag, to do whatever they want for the flag. I think that's part of democracy. You know, you don't salute your flag because you have to. You salute it because you want to, and you get to choose. And that's democracy, you know.
Yeah.
And then as far as the issues, they may be wrong in the issues. You know, no one's saying they're definitely right. But like anything else, it's bringing awareness to it, you know? So let's see what the situation is kind of.
And I feel this is a problem with politics. Like, I feel like we've stagnated in politics since, I don't know, like, you know, when I became politically aware, which is probably the late 90s, right? I don't feel like a lot has changed. And I mean, I get that there are things like, let's say gay marriage is now legal, and that's one really big example. But I kind of feel like we keep getting thrown back into the same culture wars over and over. And I think it's because... Yeah. These hard conversations are either, you know, shouted down or just ignored. You know, we're not really willing to engage.
Yeah, exactly. Because we've created, it sucks, man. We've created a system where if you say, and I feel nervous talking about this, right? Because it's like the wrong thing said labels you something. But here's the truth, and the truth the way I see it. Let me correct that.
Yeah, sure.
If you say that African Americans don't work as hard as white males, you're automatically a racist. You know, if you say that Africans and African Americans go to jail at a higher rate than white males, and this is not fair, you're automatically, you know, a liberal. No, let's not label people. Let's discuss.
Yeah,
the
right.
Statements. Right. Let's try and see the facts that may fit those statements. Let's try and have more productive conversations. And I don't see that happening, you know, because I think because like anything else, like I said before, and I'm not trying to say everything is down the middle. Of course, there is right and wrong, but there are truths to both statements that I said. I believe, you know, there's truths to both sides. So it's like let's be able to have these conversations without having to label each other.
Right. I get what your point is. And the real problem is if you shut down those conversations, you know, you're shutting down avenues to coming to some kind of resolution.
Yes, to real change that the majority can agree on.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, there might even some of these conversations make people really uncomfortable. I mean, the flag issue is a good one, right? It's you know, I don't know if change is going to come about from there. Maybe it will, maybe it won't, but it will make people uncomfortable. But we're talking about it, and maybe it does change some people's minds. And that's the point, right? Just engaging. There's this really cool dude. He's a musician named Daryl Davis, and he goes up to Klan members. Like, this is his hobby. He's a cool guy. He goes up to Klan members, and he tries to make friends with them. You know, he goes up to them, and he's gotten a lot of people to drop out of the KKK. And I mean, this is kind of one of those places where I think most people can say the KKK is bad, right? But there's a lot of issues that, you know, really probably could go in many different ways in society and still be kind of a justice. And when you don't engage, you can't convert other people. And so we just get this shouting. Yeah. And I mean, this is why I was so excited to have you on. I'm sorry if I'm just taking all your points. Like, I was just reading through.
No. Yeah, you're all good, man. And I'm happy to agree with you. I don't have to make points.
I mean, and it was kind of a question, like, how do we go about this? Should we just have like an out and out argument, or should we have some agreement? And, you know, you did bring up some things too that were sort of interesting to me. Like, it's not my personal point of view, but it is something that you were talking about, you know, and it's like this kind of fluidity of how people identify and, you know, should you have some impact on it, you know, with straight and gay, right? You know, if it's your kids and such.
Yeah.
And I thought it was kind of a fascinating question.
Yeah. Especially the thing with the kids. I think that's where the discussion really becomes trickier. It's like, okay, we want everybody to have their rights and do what makes them happy.
Yeah.
But we also have to make sure that we don't push it on other people. We have to make sure that the education system is not making gay and all these different genders so accepted and so promoted. Because, people want to argue and say, oh, no, it's not being promoted. But once something is more accepted and, you know, everything can be taken to an extreme to where it becomes a promotion or to where it becomes even a curiosity that did not need to be there.
Right. And from the other perspective, you know, from my perspective, right, I don't think just like if somebody is clearly wants to is, you know, they are gay and that is what they are. You know, I don't think we should force the other way, right? I don't think we should force.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, we shouldn't. We no, there's no way should we be shaming, you know, kids that identify as gay, as transgender, as anything, because that makes them feel uncomfortable. That makes them choose a side. You know, that makes them take pride in the position instead of, you know, discovering themselves in an honest, open way, you know?
Right, right. Yeah, it's kind of like keeping that influence out and not pushing them one way or the other, right? And I think that's, you know, that's a conversation we should be having, is that, you know, what is the proper way to, you know, I've got a 5-year-old and a, you know, 1.5-year-old, you know, it's weird to me that I'm going to have to start like having these conversations with them. Right now it's really fun. It's awesome.
Yeah.
You guys, there's so much fun, but at some point, you know, this is the things that are going to get brought up. And, you know, if you just avoid the conversation, that's not useful.
Exactly.
if you push people the wrong place, that's not good either.
Yeah, exactly. And we have to make sure we're hearing both sides.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's right. And let me get to this like one last topic that has been blowing my mind since you brought it up, right? This is, and I'm not just saying that because I have spent a lot of time just thinking about what this means. And that's what does CRISPR mean for genetic purists and societal identity?
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, what does it mean? Because we're going to be afforded maybe a lot of freedoms, maybe too much freedom as to, you know, how we can edit our genes, maybe how we can change how tall we are, who we are, whether we're gay or straight, which, by the way, I didn't get to touch up on this too. I do believe, you know, the gay and straight thing, it is biological for the most part. I do believe in that. So, it's, you know,
sure,
I'm not over here, you know, arguing that it's all nurture and it's all about how we raise our kids. No, I agree. There was friends that I knew were gay and they ended up being gay since they were, you know, 10, 12 years old. I understand. But I also think there's another side where there is a curiosity possibility. There is a spectrum of people that maybe are curious or more towards straight. And it's like, if, you know, we don't need to push them, you know, either way.
Right, right. Yeah, I get your point. I hope people can like understand this is a conversation that I think a lot of people have. And then you shouldn't just get roasted for the fact that you're trying to explore this yourself, trying to understand it. And so CRISPR is this ability to edit genes, right? It's this ability to change genes, to cut stuff out, to add stuff in. What if you're, you know, there's these really famous things where they go out and they meet up with like Nazis and they do genetic tests. And then they find out that they have, you know, impure genetics in them. Well, what if they could just cut that out, right? What does that mean?
Exactly. And, you know, no one can argue that cutting out the cure, you know, cutting out cancers or malignant diseases would be bad. That's great. That's outstanding. But I think everything can be pushed too far. Like, if we're over here in the future, it could be 1,000 years, 10,000, 300. I mean, technology is really hard to predict nowadays the way it's accelerating. It could be 50 years, you know, that you're deciding what kind of features your baby's going to have. Yeah. And I think we need to be careful with this. We need to be careful. It could be too much of an, you know, as far as an unjust system, you know, you have, this is far-fetched, but you can have, you know, rich people that can make their kids athletic and others that can't. I think there's some extremes that people need to be careful with. And then there's also, obviously, from an evolutionary standpoint, you know, mutations and variations are kind of the reason we exist, the reason we are so adapted to our environment, why we fit the environment so much.
So the reason we are top predator on the planet. Yeah.
You got to make sure we let evolution keep doing its job and, you know, keep the variation. So it's a tough conversation, but obviously it's really exciting too. Not against any of it. I think it's all great science. We should learn more and I think we're on the right path with it. I mean, it's awesome.
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, like it brings up this problem. Like, what if you have a really authoritarian government? And they decide that everyone in the country is going to look like a Star Trek Klingon, right? And now that's your new identity. You know what I mean? Like, they're just going to CRISPR that in there. And now, like, immediately, you know who doesn't belong, right? Like, you can have really crazy things that CRISPR could enable. Like, it seems plausible. And like you say, like, no one's against removing cancer. That everyone's for that. But, you know, what do we end it at? Yeah.
Absolutely. And we need to be careful with that, man. Yeah, you know, society is great the way it is in the sense that it is very unique, it's very different. Mm-hmm. You know, there's all different kinds of people, different way they act, different characters, you know, different way they look. So I think we need to honor that.
Yeah. I'm with you, man. I completely agree today, right? Maybe like 10 years from now, I'll think it was a dumb point to make, but that's kind of the idea, right? Like, let's have these conversations and let's like explore things. And so I think we're going to wrap this up, but could you give your Instagram again for the mining systems?
Oh, thank you, Michael. I appreciate it. But before I even do that, I just want to say thanks for having me on the show.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
I think your party, I've heard some of your podcasts, not enough clearly, just a little bit, but just from the gist of what I've heard and read, man, I like the way you guys are presenting this stuff. And I think you're educating young people to get into politics and get into it the right way.
Yeah, there's a lot of excitement out there. We're trying to figure out a way to funnel it in a, you know, some productive manner, you know, and it's not simple.
I hear you, man. And you know what? That's a process. And I would say treasure the process for sure, man. Don't rush to figure out exactly who you are. You know, treasure the process.
The journey's half the fun, man. It's actually probably most of the fun. Once you get there, you got to do something else.
Exactly, right?
Yep. Yeah, so Soko Mining on Instagram. Yes. We'll post a link to that. And thanks so much, Kristjan and Sokoli, for joining us. And this was Politics Within Reason. Please remember to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and call us with any feedback at 202-681-2274. You can find Kristjan on, what kind of social media do you like, Kristjan? What's your favorite?
Soko Mining is fine, man.
Right,
I've got a Steam it page off of there, too, they can link to. But so Soko Mining is plenty. I'd love for them to connect and share their currency ideas.
Check out some of these pictures of these guys building these huge machines. They're really cool. I think they're huge compared to my laptop. All right. Politics Within Reason is supported by the Party of Reason and Progress, a 527 political organization, and we'll catch you next time. Bye.